Okay.
Let's start this. Good morning, everyone. In last few classes, we have dealt with the anatomy of the oral cavity and pharynx. Today we'll continue with this classes on the clinical part of the oral cavity and pharynx. Today we are dealing with benign lesions of the oral cavity. So as we discussed before, the oral cavity includes lips, tongue, floor of the mouth, buccal mucosa, palate, and retromolar trigone. So these are the various subsides of the oral cavity. Now, depending on the subside, we'll discuss the various pathologies in these subsides. Before that, we'll deal with the terminologies, various terminologies that are used to describe the oral cavity lesions. The term lesion is a broad term for abnormal tissues in the oral cavity, which includes wounds, sores, or any other tissue damage, either by injury or disease. The first step for diagnosing and treating these illnesses is to determine the type of lesion. So the types of lesions are classified based on if they extend below the surface of the oral cavity or above the surface. So the lesions that are extending below the surface are ulcer. The definition of ulcer is, it is a defect or break in the continuity of the mucosa and also the basement membrane, and even it can extend deeper into the tissues, causing abnormal function of that organ. Erosion is similar to the ulcer, where there is a shallow defect in the mucosa caused by partial loss of the epithelium. But in this case, the basement membrane of the epithelium is intact. So this is a superficial shallow defect. Ulcer is deeper. Now coming to abscess. Abscess is nothing but a localized collection of pus in a circumscribed area. The next one is cyst. Cyst is a closed sac or pouch that has an epithelial lining, and it contains the content of this cyst is either a fluid or a semi-solid material. Now coming to lesions extending above the surface. They are blisters. Blisters are also known as vesicles. They are lesions filled with watery fluid. Pustule is similar to a vesicle, but it is filled with pus. Next coming to hematoma. Hematoma is a localized swelling that is filled with blood caused by break in the wall of the blood vessel. Next lesion is the plaque. Any patch or flat area that is slightly raised from the surface. The lesion itself is flat, but it is slightly raised from the surrounding surface. This is known as plaque. We'll discuss the various diseases, benign diseases of oral cavity under this following conditions. First one is congenital conditions. Torus. First we'll deal with torus. Torus is singular. Tori is plural. Torus is nothing but a developmental anomaly involving the hard palate and mandible. It is characterized by bony exostosis. What do you mean by exostosis? Exo means outer. Osteosis means bone growth. So exostosis means bony outgrowth. If it is seen in palate, it is known as torus palatinus. If it is seen in mandible, it is known as torus mandibularis. It is more common in the second decade of life, that is during pubertal and teenage period. This occurs due to the failure of the palatal and mandibular bone to stop growing after the fusion of the embryonic bone. These torae, they are more common in women. The torae of the palate, you can see it is in the midline, and it can appear, it can present as either a pedunculated mass or a lobulated mass. Here in this figure, you can see lobules within the torus. Now coming to mandibular tori, they are found to involve only the lingual surface of the anterior mandible, that is the inferior alveolar surface, primarily opposite to the premolar region. See, in this figure you can see the mandibular tori. See, this is the inferior alveolar arch containing teeth. This is the inner surface of the gums. This is the floor of the oral cavity. This is the ventral surface of the tongue. This is the frenulum. This one is the torus. You can see they are arising on the lingual surface of the mandible. Lingual surface. This is the lingual surface of the mandible, opposite to the premolars. See, these are incisors, canines, premolars. You can see they have multiple lobules and they're present on the either side. These are the example for this is the mandibular tori. As I said before, these tori are typically pedunculated or multilobulated. They have broad base and surface is smooth. You can see the surface is smooth. They contain dense lamellar bone. They are usually asymptomatic. In symptomatic patients, only will offer them surgical excision, either by using osteotome, or drills with cutting burrs. So in asymptomatic patients, will not advise any treatment. In symptomatic patients, will remove them from the underlying cortex either using an osteotome or cutting burrs. Recurrence is occasionally seen. It's very rare. So, and also malignant transformation is not reported. What do you mean by recurrence? That is, after excision, if they reappear, it is known as recurrence, which is rare, very much rare. Malignant transformation, it is a benign lesion, benign congenital lesion. And it does not show any tendency in later ages to transform into a malignant condition. Now coming to lingual thyroid. Am I going too fast? Just reply, then I'll continue. I want to know if you're able to understand. Okay, then I'll maintain this space because there are multiple conditions in this class to deal with. Okay. Now coming to lingual thyroid. Lingual thyroid is an example of ectopic thyroid. What do you mean by ectopic? Ectopic means it is present other than the normal expected area. So this lingual thyroid is an example of an ectopic thyroid. It occurs or it forms due to lack of descent of this thyroid tissue during embryonic development. 90% of the ectopic thyroid tissue is associated with the dorsum of the tongue. This lingual thyroid is commonly found in the midline in the area of foramen cecum. See, these are the sites. See, this green line, you can see this green line, is the line of descent of the thyroid tissue, which starts from the foramen cecum up to the neck. If there is failure in the descent, depending upon the level of descent of the thyroid tissue, there you can find this ectopic thyroid. If it doesn't descend at all, then you'll find the thyroid in the base of the tongue near the foramen cecum. Then you'll call it as lingual thyroid. Other examples are sublingual, pre-laryngeal. This is the thyroid cartilage. And if thyroid tissue is present before the larynx, it's known as pre-laryngeal. This is the normal location of the thyroid tissue. If it is present below the normal tissue, then it is known as substernum thyroid. This lingual thyroid is usually asymptomatic. The presence of lingual thyroid can be associated with hypothyroidism. So if symptoms are present, they're present only due to the decrease in the or less amount of the thyroid hormone. There is hypothyroid symptoms. They are usually symptomatic. Sometimes they may show symptoms of hypothyroidism. Sometimes during developmental period, like during puberty or in during pregnancy, there is high requirement of thyroid hormone. So this lingual thyroid also overworks to produce more amount of the hormone and becomes hypertrophy. So whenever this lingual thyroid hypertrophies, it causes obstruction because of its mass effect. What do you mean by mass effect? Means it directly is causing obstruction either to airway or to the food passage. So the symptoms are due to mass effect are airway obstruction, difficulty in swallowing, and sensation of mass or lump in the throat. So these symptoms usually occur, as I told you before, during increased metabolic demands, that is either during puberty where there are growth spurts or during pregnancy. The malignant transformation is rare, also rare in this condition. See, this is the location of the lingual thyroid. You know, the location of foramen cecum is at the apex of the circumvallid papillae, dividing the tongue into anterior two-thirds or oral tongue and posterior one-third or pharyngeal tongue. So it is present at the level of the foramen cecum. So this is the lingual thyroid. So what investigations you want to do in this case? Because you want to know if the person is having enough thyroid hormone, that is euthyroid or not. You'll do T3, T4, THS level assays. And also you want to do an ultrasound scan of the neck. Why do you want to do the ultrasound of the neck? Because you want to find out if the normal thyroid is present or not along with this lingual thyroid. This is important because in symptomatic cases, if you go for excision without doing the scan for the neck, and if normal thyroid is not present, the patient will land up into hypothyroidism. He has to take thyroid supplements for lifelong. So in symptomatic cases, you want to excise this lingual thyroid. So the approaches are two types. One is transcervical, that is through the neck. Another one is transoral, through the oral cavity. The transcervical route is by means of lateral pharyngotomy. You will give an incision laterally to the pharynx and you will reach on the lateral side. Or transhyoid pharyngotomy, this is the hyoid bone. You will go through this region. And transorally using a CO2 laser. So these are the methods for surgical excision in symptomatic patients. Symptomatic and euthyroid patients. That is, hormone levels are normal, but patient is having symptoms like dysphagia or dyspnea. So post-operatively, even if there is presence of normal tissue, the patient may land up into hypothyroidism. So we'll give him thyroid replacement therapy in post-operative period. Now coming to inflammatory and traumatic conditions of the oral cavity. Initially, we'll deal with traumatic conditions. The first one is the fibroma or fibroepithelial polyp. It is the most common lesion caused due to trauma, having more female predilection. That is more common in the females. It can occur throughout the oral cavity, but more common in the along the bite line. What do you mean by bite line? Bite line is nothing but a line in the buccal cavity which is parallel to the line of occlusion of the both the jaws. That is, when you close the jaws, a line of occlusion, that is where the point where both the teeth come in contact, which is parallel to the buccal cavity, is known as bite line. See, if both the jaws close, the bite line will be at this level. So these fibromas you'll commonly see in this region. these are due to trauma. They're usually solitary, not larger than 1.5 centimeters. They're asymptomatic. They can either be sessile or pedunculated. They're initially sessile, you can see. If the size increases because of the repeated trauma, they may hang down with a peduncle. Then they become pedunculated. Microscopically or histologically, they contain dense cellular fascicle, non-cellular or minimal cellular fascicles of collagen fibers having and relatively a vascular appearance. So predominantly they contain collagen fibers. The treatment is usually in asymptomatic cases, will not suggest any surgery. We'll go with the conservative approach. If the lesion increases in size, we can offer them excision. Recurrence is unlikely, but if you don't deal with the cause of the trauma here, it will reappear. The causes of trauma may be jagged teeth. These teeth, the edges may get roughened up and come in contact with this buccal cavity, causing irritation. So we have to soften this jagged teeth. Okay. Now coming to pyogenic granuloma. This also occurs due to acute or chronic trauma or infection. They are highly vascular lesions commonly seen over the gums. They are similar to the granulation tissue. They can either be raised, simply raised lesions, or pedunculated. When you take a biopsy, you will find multinucleated foreign body like Jane cells separated by fibroangiomatous stroma. The treatment is simple excision and removal. And also, we have to look for the cause for this recurrent trauma and we have to deal with that. Otherwise, again, it will repeat. Now coming to inflammatory or infective lesions. Initially, we'll deal with the viral lesions. So, the inflammation of mouth is known as stomatitis. So, we want to deal with this initial terminology so that you not get confused. Inflammation of lips is known as chelitis. Inflammation of gums is known as gingivitis. Inflammation of tongue is known as glossitis. This glossitis more commonly you'll see in vitamin or iron deficiency conditions. Okay. Now we'll start with this viral pathologies. First one is the herpetic gingivostomatitis. In name itself, it means it is a viral infection caused by herpes simplex virus involving the gingiva and mouth. So, it is more commonly caused by herpes simplex virus. One, type 2 causes lesions in the genitourinary tract. Oral cavity lesions and other dermatological skin lesions are caused by the herpes simplex 1. The presentation is usually by the small multiple vesicles. They appear at the mucocutaneous junction. So, this is the mucocutaneous junction. You can see the lesions here. Initially, they appear as multiple small vesicles. These vesicles, they rupture in 1 to 7 days, leaving ulcerations. These ulcerations typically heal over 7 to 10 days. This primary infection is characterized by other symptoms like, apart from these lesions, fever, arthralgia, generalized malaise, headache, and cervical lymphadenopathy. The greatest infectivity occurs when these vesicles rupture and the fluid within the vesicle spills out. That is the period where there is highest infectivity. Now coming to reactivation phase. These are usually self-limiting. They heal, the patient recovers from this condition on his own. Okay. Reactivation. So the person recovers from the lesions doesn't mean that the virus exited the body. what happens is these viruses, they migrate into the sensory ganglia and they stay dormant there until they come across a triggering factor. This is known as reactivation. These are normally occurs in 16 to 45% of the patients with HSV. The usual triggers are exposure to UV light, stress, infection due to other etiology, and also immunosuppression. These immunosuppressions may include either diabetic conditions or chronic illnesses or a patient taking immunosuppressive drugs. The typical presentation during reactivation are same. Initially, vesicles erupt on the mucocutaneous junctions of the lips and other parts of the oral cavity. They later rupture to form an ulcer. Then the ulcer heals by crusting in 17 to 14 days. There is a particular period in this reactivation known as prodromal period. Prodromal period. This occurs before the appearance of the vesicle. The patient complains of tingling, intense itching, burning at the site of the lesion just prior to the vesicular eruption. So, the diagnosis is by typical clinical picture, that is vesicles present at the mucocutaneous junction, followed by or accompanied by fever, arthralgia, and generalized meningitis with cervical lymphadenopathy. So, other modalities for diagnosis are, we'll collect this fluid from unruptured vesicle and we'll send it for PCR, which is a much faster and better. You can also send for culture, but it is a slow process. If you take a smear from this infected fluid from the vesicle, you'll find the multinucleated giant cells. Now, serological testing, that is, you'll take a blood sample and you'll test, you'll send the sample to the lab to test for the antibodies against the HSV. The two methods, one is ELISA and Western blot. Well, ELISA is faster and it is used for, it is a, like a screening procedure. Western blot is confirmative. It is very accurate, but it takes a long time. These are various modalities. You can see vesicles in the mucocutaneous junction involving gingiva. Once the vesicle structure, they form crusting. See, these are the pictures showing the various stages. These are the vesicles presenting at the mucocutaneous junction at the angles of the oral commissures. Treatment is conservative. You will give for the antipyretics for fever, analgesic for pain, and hydration, adequate hydration. Valacyclovir and famciclovir can be given to decrease the level of symptoms, but not for cure. Once the vesicles appear, it normally subsides within 7 to 14 days, but to decrease the symptoms and to decrease the complaints of the patient, we'll add this antiviral drugs. But if you prescribe during prodromal period, you can decrease. Okay, sorry for the interruption. There has been a technical problem. So, can you hear me right now? Please respond. Can you hear me or not? Yeah, right. So the treatment for HSV is conservative. We'll give antipyretics, analgesics, and hydration. Valacyclovir and famciclovir are given to decrease the intensity of the symptoms. Now coming to varicella zoster. So the primary infection of varicella zoster is known as chickenpox, and secondary infection is known as shingles. The spread of this infection is by respiratory droplet infection. Incubation period is 14 days or 2 weeks. The primary infection, that is chickenpox, it is characterized by fever, headache, malaise, and a rash. This rash initially presents as vesicles. When there is secondary bacterial infection, it converts into pustules. It ruptures to form ulcers. These ulcers heal by crusting. So these vesicles are present over the entire body and also oral cavity. In the oral cavity, they typically involve the buccal mucosa and hard palate. These ulcers, they resemble the aftercells of the oral cavity. The entire period of this disease lasts for 7 to 10 days. Diagnosis is by the clinical picture of the location and distribution of the vesicles. By that you can diagnose the this disease. Apart from this, we can do direct fluorescent antibody test. Other tests are ELISA and PCR. Treatment is also conservative. You can use supportive therapy using antipyretics, analgesics, and hydration. When in severe forms of the disease, you'll give valacyclovir and acyclovir to decrease the intensity of the symptoms. We have to monitor for the secondary bacterial infection, particularly streptococcus. Because during any viral infection, the innate immunity of the body decreases, providing increased chance for secondary bacterial infection. Now coming to shingles. Shingles is a secondary infection. As we talked with the HSV before, this once the infection subsides, it doesn't mean the virus exits the body. It gets it migrates into the sensory ganglion all over the body. The presentation of this secondary infection is commonly seen in immunocompromised patients, not in the immunocompetent ones. The presentation includes prodrome of burning, pain, or pain over the particular dermatome where the virus lies dormant. Prodrome means the symptoms that appear before the onset of the vesicles or rash. Initially, the maculopapular rash develops in the vesicular form. They get infected, become pustule, they rupture and form ulcerations. Ultimately, these ulcerations heal with crusting. The oral lesions are typically occur after the skin involvement. So first you'll get skin rashes, then oral cavity and oral mucosa is involved. Treatment is usually supportive. Can also be severe forms. In severe forms, we can treat them with valacyclovir and acyclovir. See, these are the oral lesions of varicella zoster. You can see this, they mimic the aftercells. These are the lesions of rash over the skin. These are the lesions in the oral cavity. Now coming to candidiasis. See, the candida is a type of yeast-like fungi. They form the normal flora of the oral cavity. They are present in 40 to 65% of the patients. But they cause infection only in case of immunocompromised state. They normally occur in the oral cavity, but they do not cause infection. They cause infection in immunocompromised conditions or oral trauma or recent heavy antibiotic use. They are rare in healthy individuals. A recent study found that 90% of HIV positive patients are typically affected with this oral candidiasis. There are several forms of this candidiasis, like pseudomembranous candidiasis, also known as oral thrush, is the most commonest form. It presents as a white plaque. Plaque means a lesion which is flat, but it is raised a few millimeters from the surroundings. Whenever this plaque is scraped off, we can find beefy red base of ulceration which is tender on palpation. See this picture, this is known as oral thrush. If you remove this plaque, underlying there is ulcers. Other type of candidiasis are atrophic candidiasis. The subtypes include chronic atrophic and angular keelitis. These atrophic candidiasis are usually seen in patients with denture usage. You can see this is the edentate individual wearing dentures. Edentate means all the teeth are pulled out. This is only, you can see, in alveolar margin is seen. These patients, they keep dentures, temporary dentures. So along these dentures, if the person is immunocompromised, you can find this atrophic candidiasis characterized by erythematous patch. Erythematous patch. Now coming to mucocutaneous candidiasis. It is a most severe form. A patient is usually typically very ill prior to the presentation. There is diffuse involvement of oral cavity, lips, skin, and other mucosal surfaces. The oral cavity involvement include lesions similar to pseudomembranous candidiasis or oral thrush. The diagnosis is by typical clinical picture, and also the scrapings from the oral cavity, you'll transfer into it a KOH mount and you'll observe under a microscope. Then you can see this pseudo hyphae and the yeast like fungi in the slide. Apart from this, you can culture the samples of the scrapings on saccharose, dextrose, agar. Remember, you are taught in microbiology. And also there's another newer test known as 1,3 beta D glucon detection assay. In cases which are unclear, we'll opt for this assay. Mild to acute conditions, you treat with topical nystatin. Mild to chronic conditions, you treat with topical nystatin and also clotrimazole. The cases which are refractory to the above drugs and also immunocompromised without systemic involvement, you'll go for oral fluconazole. But before starting oral fluconazole, we have to know the liver status. You know the liver status by doing liver function tests. If the liver function test is normal, then you'll go for oral fluconazole. And also you monitor the patient with repeated LFTs so that you want to know if you want to continue with this drug or not. In severe systemic forms, you'll treat with IV amphotericin B with or without fluconazole. These are the few examples for oral candidiasis. Now coming to bacterial infection. The common ones are Vincent's angina or trench mouth. It's caused by Borrelia vincenti or fusiform bacilli. They are also normal commensals. They are present in the oral cavity, but they cause infection whenever the patient immunity decreases or decreasing the nutrition or disease fighting capability of the patient decreases. They cause infections. They present with punched out erosions, which ultimately leads into ulceration and spreads into the surrounding gum margin. And they're covered by a pseudomembrane. Pseudomembrane. See, these are a few examples showing Vincent's angina. This is a classical picture. Lesion covered with the whitish pseudomembrane. Now coming to autoimmune diseases of the oral cavity. So autoimmune diseases means the immune system of the body is attacking the normal healthy tissue within the body. This is the gist for autoimmune disease. The commonest autoimmune diseases we know are lupus erythematosus. That is, it is seen in 40 to 50 cases per 100,000 people. They are of two types, discoid variety and systemic variety. In discoid variety, it contains it causes skin lesions, oral cavity lesions without visceral involvement. In systemic condition, it also includes visceral involvement. So in discoid variety of lupus erythematosus, in 25% cases, you can find oral lesions. In systemic lupus erythematosus, in about 40% of the cases, you can find the oral lesions. Now coming to what are the oral manifestations of this autoimmune disease? It presents as a erythematous plaque or erosions that can evolve into ulcerations. See, you can see erythematous plaque seen over the mucocutaneous junction of the lip. Ultimately, they cause crusting. Now coming to white keratotic striae radiating from lesion margins. See, this is an example of white keratotic striae. Nothing but they are raised regions in this lesions which are white in color. White keratotic striae. They arise from the lesions. These are the two characteristic features of the oral lesions. They may involve the buccal mucosa, gingiva, labial mucosa, and vermilion border. Diagnosis is by typical butterfly appearance of the rash of the face and also lab investigations like immunofluorescent tests for antigen antibody complexes and anti-nuclear antibody tests, SSA-SSB antibodies, anti-dsDNA antibodies. All this you have learned in your pathology. Treatment is for oral lesions, you can give no treatment is needed, but if you want to give, you will give topical corticosteroids to improve the symptoms from the oral lesions. For systemic conditions, you will give corticosteroids with cytotoxic drugs like cyclophosphamide, azathioprine, in some cases methotrexate. See, these are the examples of the lesions. Now coming to pemphigoid. Pemphigoid is a dermatological condition where it affects the layers of the skin. It's a rare condition affecting less than 200,000 people in United States. Now coming to bullous pemphigoid. In bullous pemphigoid, the antibodies, our own antibodies, are directed against the epithelial basement membrane, causing the inflammatory response. This is characterized by lesions that appear as vesicles and they rupture to form the ulcerations. Predominantly is a dermatological condition, but is also formed in the mucous membrane of the oral cavity in 40% cases. Diagnosis is by biopsy and immunofluorescence showing IgG and complement, C3 complement in a linear fashion along the basement membrane. How do you treat this case? By systemic steroids with or without cytotoxic agents. Topical steroids sometimes prescribed for symptomatic relief. In extreme cases, we give IV immunoglobulin when over the course of period, the patient gets resistance to the steroids and the cytotoxic drugs. Other form, we discussed about bullous pemphigoid. This is cicatricial pemphigoid. As the name indicates, it causes cicatrization or scarring. It is seen in 85% of the cases and it can be the only presentation. Now coming to pemphigus vulgaris. Among these pemphigoid conditions, the most common one is the pemphigus vulgaris. In this, the antibody is directed at the intracellular bridges. In bullous pemphigoid, the antibodies are directed at the basement membrane. Here, intracellular bridges, that is the linkages between the cells. This causes inflammatory response and separation of individual cells in the epithelial layer, causing bulle formation. They are thin-walled bulle. These lesions, they occur at the oral cavity first, then skin becomes involved. There's a special sign known as Nikolsky sign is positive in pemphigus vulgaris. When you scrape the mucosa where the lesion is, it causes sloughing or sliding of the mucosa over the underlying surface. This is known as Nikolsky sign. There's a 2 marks question for you. See, this is example for pemphigus vulgaris. So if you scrape it, this entire lesion, the upper layer of the lesion, of sloughs off. This is known as Nikolsky sign. Biopsy shows tombstone appearance, showing dead epithelial cells and also Zanck cells. If you do immunofluorescence, you can see these immunoglobulins getting deposited over the cell-cell adhesion junctions, causing an eliciting an inflammatory response. Treatment is by high doses of systemic steroids and cytotoxic agents. In some cases, plasmapheresis, that is removing of the proteins in the plasma, has been utilized to showing good results. Coming to Behçet syndrome, this is also a systemic autoimmune condition. It's a kind of vasculitis. Incidence is seen in 1 in 10,000 cases. It's more common in males, characterized by aphthous ulcerations. Other lesions like genital lesions, eye lesions causing uveitis and retinal vasculitis, skin lesions, polyarthritis and meningoencephalitis. Treatment include oral gargling with tetracycline solution, topical steroid creams for oral cavity and genital lesions, and systemic steroids. So this is an example for showing Behçet's syndrome. Now coming to lichen planus, this is a 4 marks question for you. In this, previously antibodies are attacking the layers of the skin or mucous membrane. Here, lichen planus. In lichen planus, T cells, they destroy the basal layer of the epidermis. It is characterized by 5 P's. Purple, pruritic, planar, polygonal, papules. Oral cavity involvement is seen in 70% cases. The oral lesions appear in various varieties like reticular, wherever reticular means net-like, white stria and buccal mucosa, but they do not scrape off like in oral candidiasis or leukoplakia. Plaque-like, they resemble leukoplakia, but they cannot be scraped off. Bullous, their rare form, they appear like bullae and they rupture, causing ulceration. Erosive, very painful and erythematic lesions with fibrous covering. See, this is the example for reticular variety, net-like. This is an example for plaque-like variety. So, the treatment include the malignant, there is a slight tendency for malignant transformation. Diagnosis is by skin biopsy with histopathological examination and immunofluorescence. Treatment is by typical oral steroids and cyclosporine. Like it's a cyclosporine immunomodulator. It's an immunomodulator. In severe disease, you'll use systemic steroids. Now coming to aphthous ulcers or canker sores. This is the most common non-traumatic ulceration of the pleural cavity, seen in 10 to 20% of the general population. There are two types, minor aphthous ulcers and major aphthous ulcers. Minor aphthous ulcers are less than 1 centimeter. They're present in the oral mucosa. They can involve anywhere in the oral mucosa. It is characterized by well delineated white lesion with a erythematous halo. See, well delineated white lesion with erythematous halo. So it is characterized by burning or tingling in the area prior to ulcer appearance. It resolves in 7 to 10 days. They do not scar. Typically like infective conditions involving viruses. Other part is major aphthous ulcers. It is also known as Sutton's disease or periodontitis mucosa necrotica recurrence. It is greater than 1 centimeter in diameter. It involves the mucosa of the oral cavity that include tongue and palate. Minor aphthous ulcers, they resolve by 6 weeks. They do not resolve by 6 weeks. typically scarring occurs. Typically, there is scarring upon healing. Treatment is by topical steroids and cauterization with 10% silver nitrate. Rarely, you can use tetracycline dissolved in water to rinse the mouth. To decrease the to give symptomatic relief from the local pain, we use Liglocaine viscous and apply on the local area so that the patient gets relief from the pain. So we'll stop the class here. Because of the technical issue, we have to stop here. So we'll deal with the next, that is the pre-malignant conditions on the oral cavity next class. I know you have doubts now. Whatever you have doubts, just mail me. I'll touch upon those topics again in the next class before starting the pre-malignant conditions. Okay? If you respond, then I'll stop the class today because you have ophthalmology class now. Whatever you have doubt, I'll again repeat it in the next class. Just reply so that I'll leave. You have my mail ID, right? Just mail me what are the topics you want to cover. Again, I'll repeat it again, definitely. Okay? Thank you.
Morgan, I think. Yeah, I'm just coming to that.